Jesus rose with all power in his hands. Jesus rose with all power in his hands.
Well, he died on Friday,
Friday,
but he rose upon Sunday.
Sunday,
just before the break of day,
just before the break of day,
it was early on Sunday,
morning,
it was just before the break of day,
early on Sunday morning,
it was
just before the break of day,
but Jesus rose.
Deep within me. was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me, who the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child.
Survey. sweetest frame, but holy trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord.
And welcome to the online services of the Waters Road Church of Christ. On this Easter Sunday morning, we are so delighted that you've chosen to be with us. Join with us as we worship and praise our Lord and Savior.
Praise the Lord, ye heavens, adore Him. Praise Him, angels in the high.
So thankful for each and every one of you. I just want to say from the Stover family, we miss each and every one of you so much and can't wait to be back together with you again. If you would pray with me. Father in heaven, we are so thankful for today. Thankful for the time that we get to spend honoring your name, singing to you and praying to you and listening to your word. Father, we pray that you will help each and every one of us to honor you with our lives and with our words. Father, I pray that you will be with us as a church, just as we're apart from each other. Father, I pray that you will help us to stay encouraged and to stay faithful. Father, this morning I want to lift up our brothers and sisters around the world and at Waters Road. Father, I pray that you be with those who are struggling. I pray that you be with those who are sick. I pray for a cure, Father, that you will heal them and help them at this time. Father, I also pray for those who have lost jobs. I pray that you will provide for them and help them with the things that they need. I pray that we as brothers and sisters will be there for them and help them with those things also. Father, this morning I also pray for those that are around the world who have lost loved ones and who are sick. Father, this morning we pray for your comfort and for your help in this situation. Father, I pray that you help each and every one of us to see you in our lives. Father, also this morning, I just want to thank you for your Son who came to this earth and gave his life for each and every one of us. We thank you for the time that we get to spend together on here, honoring your name and glorifying you. Thank you for being a good God and being faithful in all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well.
I want to encourage you at this time to go ahead and take out your Bible or your Bible app, and let's open together in the New Testament to the book of 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 2. And you can also do this. Take out your Bible study outlines that you would have received in your weekly newsletter so you can follow along and take notes as we study God's Word together this morning. Let me begin by sharing with you a strange but true story that happened 29 years ago with a Russian cosmonaut named Sergei Krikalev. Sergei, back in 1991, he was on board the Mir space station. And he was supposed to be up there a couple of months doing experiments for the Soviet Union. But folks, you want to talk about bad timing. While he was up there in space, this happened to be the collapse of the Soviet Union. USSR collapsed, and so Mission Control contacts him on the space station, and they say, "Sergei, we've got some bad news. We're canceling your flight home because things have gotten very crazy down here. So just hang on tight." Now, you think that you've had a bad day when your flight back to Houston gets canceled? Can you just imagine for a moment your flight back home to Earth being canceled? But that's exactly what happened for Sergei. And they said, "Hold on tight." And so he did. Now, he was supposed to come home after 2 months in July of 1991, but it was 8 months after that, at the end of March of 1992, before he was able to return home. Folks, when he finally returned to Earth, he had to be carried because he could not walk anymore. He had spent so much time up there in space, and basically the world that he came back home to was totally different. The president that he had left with is gone. The country that he had left with is gone. The government's gone. The flag is gone. The national anthem had been changed. He left the USSR and came back to Russia. He left Leningrad and came back to St. Petersburg. It was a crazy time. They tore down statues of Brezhnev and other men of that nature, and they replaced them, check this out, with statues of men like George Washington. Folks, this was a totally different world that this guy came home to. Everything changed. Folks, that's the world in which we live. Everything's changing. Everything around you is constantly changing. 20 years ago, think about it, there was no iPhone, there was no iPad, there was no iTunes, there was no Harry Potter, there was no Avengers, there was no Lord of the Rings, there was no American Idol or Voice, there was no high-definition television, there was no YouTube, there was no Facebook, there was no Google, and there was no Twitter. Oh, how did we ever survive, right? But that's just in the last couple of decades. Things have changed rapidly. Things are changing all the time. Things are changing every day. In fact, folks, right now, due to the coronavirus, our world is changing in ways that none of us could have ever imagined. Think about it right now. There are no sports, no movies, no theaters, no concerts, none of the things that we've been programmed to think are so common to our lives. It's even affected the church, has it not? Here we are, we're worshiping together in our homes. We're live streaming our times of worship. We're fellowshipping via Zoom meetings. Everything is changing in this world. We live in an ever-changing world, but there is one thing that simply does not change, and that is God. God does not change. In fact, look at how James puts this in James chapter 1 in verse 17. He says this, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Theologians have a big word for this. They'll tell you that God is immutable. But that just simply means that God does not change. He is unchanging. Now, there are two absolute facts. Number one is that everything and every person around you is constantly changing. This was something that I've had to learn the hard way in my life. That people do change and things in this world change. Number two, the second absolute fact is this: God simply does not change. Look at how the writer of Hebrews puts this in Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 8. He says this: Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, there in the Bible are several different descriptions of God that can help us to understand God's unchanging nature. For example, God is called an anchor. Or God is called a rock. God is even called a fortress. Why? Think about it, good folks. When you're in the midst of the storms of life, you need an anchor for your soul. In the midst of the battles of life, you need a fortress. And whenever everything around you is crumbling down, you need the solid rock of Jesus Christ to stand on. All those images of God, they are all saying the same thing to you this morning. And what is it? They're saying, you can trust God. God is trustworthy. Folks, I want you to turn to the person next to you this morning in the room, wherever you may be worshiping this morning. I want you to turn to the person next to you this morning and say, you can trust God. Now, Jonathan, why are you making such a big deal out of this? It's because I know some of you out there this morning, some of you out there have had a hard time with relationships. Some of you have been burnt, haven't you? For some of you, your vows have been broken. Trust has been betrayed. Promises unkept. So maybe this morning you're wondering, Jonathan, who in this world can I trust? Good folks, God says, I am trustworthy. You can trust me. In fact, look how God says this in Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 9. God says, know that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God who keeps his gracious covenant loyalty for 1,000 generations with those who love him and keep his commands. Do you hear this morning what God is saying to you? God is saying, you can trust me. I am faithful. I am true. I'm not like everybody else out there that breaks their promises. I'm going to come through for you. So what the Apostle Paul does this morning is he's going to bring up to young Timothy how Timothy can continue to trust in God. But before that, I've got to set this up for you. Because the Apostle Paul, here in 2 Timothy, he's writing to Timothy, and these are the last recorded words of the Apostle Paul. Paul's been arrested. He's being held for trial by the Emperor Nero. Nero hates Christians, and we know via history that just a few days after penning these words, Paul was beheaded. So these, in fact, are Paul's final words. And he's saying to Timothy, Timothy, I get it. Your life has been turned upside down. Everything's changing around you, and you're wondering, who can you really trust? Can you trust God? You see, suddenly Christianity at this time was under a great deal of persecution. Everyone is hiding, and even Timothy, who's the evangelist here at Ephesus, he's starting to back away and become timid. And Paul is saying to him, Timothy, don't back away. Keep trusting. Keep pressing into God. Why? Because God is faithful. Paul, in the next few verses, is going to remind young Timothy of words that he has heard before. Because in our passage this morning, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 through 13, you'll notice in many of your Bibles that these verses are formatted just a bit differently than the others. And the reason why is these words, it's like that of poetry. Maybe this is a song that the early church sang together, or maybe even typical words of faith that Christians would utter. Paul's saying, I want to remind you of these truths. These words are faithful and true. So let's look at it now. 2 Timothy chapter 2, beginning in verse 11. Paul gives us four statements, and the amazing thing is they all demonstrate an aspect of the unchanging faithfulness of God. What I want you to do this morning in your Bible study outline, I'd like to jot down together these four things. The first way that you can count on an unchanging God in a changing world is this. Again, jot this down. Number one, God is faithful to give life. God is faithful to give life. Look at verse 11. It says, for if we died with him, we will also live with him. Now, the Apostle Paul, we know, is facing physical death. We know that he's going to be executed in a few days. And Paul is saying, hey, Timothy, don't worry about me. If I die, I die in Christ. And if I die, I'm going to live. You see, when I breathe my last breath on this earth, I'll start breathing my first breath of heaven. But what's interesting here is that Paul is not just talking about dying and then going to heaven. Look again at the tense of the verb in verse 11. For if we, circle this, died with him. Good folks, that's past tense. That's something that had already happened. Well, what is it? What happened? Good folks, at the moment that you were baptized into Jesus Christ, you died spiritually and Jesus Christ started living inside of you. Jesus told us what this moment looks like. It's found in Luke chapter 9 and verse 23. Jesus says, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. Good folks, thankfully that's what happened with me many years ago. You see, whenever sinner Jonathan repented of his sins and was buried with Christ in baptism, at that moment, the sinner Jonathan died, but the good news is the newborn Christian Jonathan started living. God began to fill me from that point forward with his Holy Spirit, and he started changing me from the inside out. And the good news is he's doing that for you as well. This is repeated over and over again in the New Testament. But one of my favorite verses is found in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. It says this, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. One of my favorite quotes of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is actually found in his very last sermon. Now, if you're familiar with his history, you know that he preached his last sermon in Memphis literally the night before he was assassinated. And what is crazy is in that sermon, he almost sounds prophetic in a sense as he tells of how he doesn't think he's going to be living much longer. And yet, even though he doesn't think he's going to be living much longer, he still experiences the joy of living in Christ. I want you to listen together this morning to his final words in his final sermon. Check it out.
Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. And I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
Folks, that is powerful, is it not? I mean, think about it. What does he say? He says, I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Folks, here is someone a day away from death, and he has this glorious attitude. Now, how's that possible? It's possible because when you die in Jesus Christ, you experience life. You see, God promises you life. Whenever you surrender your life to him, he promises you life. So again, the first thing that Paul says here this morning, he says that you can know that God is faithful to give you life. The second way that God is faithful in this ever-changing world is this. Jot this down. Number two, God is faithful to reward endurance. Look at it in verse number 12. If we endure, we will also reign with him. The truth is, God rewards endurance. Whenever you go through struggles and trials in this life, and you experience times of suffering, and you persevere, God rewards that. In fact, did you know that everything that you do in Christ, as you trust in Christ, there is an eternal reward for that? I'm not making this up, folks. The Bible says that you can give a cup of cold water in Jesus' name, and there is an eternal reward for that. But what happens with most of us is that whenever life gets tough, whenever life's a little hard, what we do, our natural tendency, it's not to persevere, it's to back away, it's to quit. Why? Because so many of us as Christians, we think the Christian life is supposed to be something easy. Now, I don't know where this started in the American church, that somehow we started hearing and believing that, okay, you become a follower of Jesus Christ and everything's going to be rosy. Everything's going to be awesome and you'll have all this success and you'll have all this victory. And folks, they'll say stuff like, you're going to be so happy, healthy, and wealthy, and you're a son or a daughter of the king and you're going to reign. Well, you're going to reign. You're going to reign with Jesus one day, but that's in heaven. And from time to time, we are reminded in the midst of this time right now, even in the midst of this pandemic, we live in a fallen, broken world. And so every one of us are going to have seasons of tribulation that you have to walk through. The Apostle Paul puts it like this to young Christians in Acts chapter 14 and verse 22. He said this: "It is necessary to go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God." So we're going to go through some hardships. We're going to go through some difficult times. And yet the tendency of many Christians is to stop and back away, not to persevere. Yet I believe one of the greatest characteristics of a true Christian is perseverance. Those who persevere until the end. Unfortunately, I see it from time to time when people start going through a rough time. Let's call it a rough patch. They don't persevere, they bail. When they're going through a rough patch in their marriage, they bail. They have a rough patch with their children, they bail. Things aren't ideal with their church, they bail. Unfortunately, this happens, but we as Christians are to be different. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 58, he says this: "Be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the Lord's work, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." Every time we have a rough patch in life, Satan whispers to us, just bail. But God says, persevere, and you will find that the reward is worth it all. There's a third thing we learn about God's faithfulness in this morning's text. Jot this down. Number three, God is faithful to bring judgment. There's a sobering reality check for us all here in verse number 12. It says, if we deny him, he will also deny us. Now, maybe this morning, someone out there watching this stream wonders, Jonathan, well, what does that mean? Well, to deny him means that you have rejected Christ. You have said, I am not going to follow Jesus Christ. I want to go my own way, and I want to do my own thing. Now, this is not a temporary denial. I mean, we know for a fact that the Apostle Peter, he denied even knowing Jesus three times. Remember that? But immediately, he was broken. He confessed his sin, and God restored him and used him in incredible ways. So this is not a temporary denial. This is a permanent denial. This is a rejection of Jesus Christ. And Paul says, if you deny Christ, he's going to deny you. In fact, Jesus said a very similar thing in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 32. Look at what God's word says. It says, therefore, everyone who will acknowledge me before others, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will also deny him before my Father in heaven. Folks, unfortunately, there are many today, yes, even some Christians today, who don't really believe there's any true consequences for denying God. But God says there are consequences. God's faithful. He's faithful to his promises, and he's also faithful to his judgment. Whenever God makes a promise, good or bad, you can take that promise to the bank. You can lean into it. You can rest on it. You can depend upon it. God is true to his word and his promises. When he promises something, you know it's going to happen. In fact, the word of God says, heaven and earth will surely fall away, but God's word will stand. So far, Paul says, okay, God is faithful in one, two, three ways. But here today is the fourth and final way that we see in this passage. Jot this down. Number four is this. God is faithful even when we're faithless. Look again at verse 13. Good folks, if we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Now, when I studied this for the first time many years ago, these words in number 4 hit me so unexpectedly. I mean, this is something completely different from the other 3 statements. All the others were cause and effect. Do you see that? If you do this, then God's gonna do that, right? For instance, if you die with Christ, you're gonna live. If you persevere, you're going to reign. If you deny him, he's going to deny you. We see that, right? And then you almost expect him to do this very same thing here in number 4. It's almost as if we expect it to say, if you're faithless, well, God's going to be faithless to you. But that's not what happens here, is it? That's not what it says. It says God's going to remain faithful because he cannot deny himself. Folks, this is one of the greatest promises in the entire Bible. Trust me on this, because each of us are going to have our seasons of doubt. We're going to have our spiritual struggles. We're going to drift away from God for a season. God says, even when you are drifting, I'm still faithful to you. Even when you're doubting, I'm still faithful to you. Why? Listen to the answer, you see, here this morning, because whenever God enters into a covenant with you, he stays true to his side of the covenant. Now, maybe you're sitting there this morning, you know somebody, and you may say, but Jonathan, what about this person? This person over here, he or she is not faithful. None of us are faithful. Every one of us at one time or another have broken our side of the covenant. What I'm telling you this morning is that the blood of Jesus Christ is enough to cover all your sins, all of your waywardness, whatever it may be. Jesus Christ is all sufficient. God even says, when you are faithless in your side of the bargain, I'm going to be faithful. Now, God gives us an incredible example of this in the Old Testament with a prophecy of Hosea. If you are familiar with this story, we know that Hosea was a very godly man. He was a prophet in the Old Testament. In fact, he had incredible status within the community of Judea. And then one day, God comes to him and says, hey, Hosea, I'm going to give you a wife. I can just imagine for a brief moment, Hosea's like, yes, thank you, God, for this. And then God says, okay, here it is. I want you to marry this girl over there. Her name is Gomer. And Hosea's like, God, are you sure? Gomer, she's a prostitute. In fact, God goes on to say, she's not just a prostitute, she's worse. She's not just selling her body because she's desperate. God says, Hosea, I want you to marry her. And Hosea does what God says, and he marries Gomer. Now, you would think that Gomer would say to herself, this man has made me his wife and gotten me off the streets. You know what? He's a good guy and he's so faithful to me, so I'm going to be faithful to him. That's what we would expect would happen, right? And the truth is, she is faithful for a short season. And they even have a child together. But then they have a second child. And Hosea realizes, this child is not mine. And then they have a third child together. And Hosea realizes, this child is not mine. And then by the third chapter, Hosea is heartbroken. He's overwhelmed. He's raising children that he knows are not his children. And Gomer's gone. She's totally faithless. And so what happens next is that years later, God comes back to Hosea and says, Hosea, I want you to go down to the slave market. And so Hosea does what God says. He goes down to the slave market. And folks, on the slave block that day is his ex-wife, Gomer. Folks, she's being sold for half the price of all the other women because her life is so worn out and so messed up. And God says, Hosea, I want you to buy her back. Imagine for a moment, from the perspective of Gomer, here she is, and she hears this voice from the back of the room, and she says, that voice sounds so familiar. In fact, that's the voice of my ex-husband. That's the man that I was unfaithful to and hurt so deeply. And then Hosea comes forward and says, I don't care what the price is. I want her back. And God says to us here this morning, this is how much I love my children. That's how much I love you. You've been faithless. You've wandered around on me. You've prostituted yourself with this world. And God says, I know you haven't been faithful to me, but I'm still faithful to you. Because of my son, Jesus Christ, I will be faithful to you even when you are faithless. Let me tell you something this morning. You've never experienced that kind of faithful love until you've known God's love. Maybe this morning there's somebody watching this who feels a lot like Gomer. You're like, man, I have messed up opportunity after opportunity after opportunity. There's no way that God could ever take me back. Can I tell you this morning, you may have wandered away, but if you still have breath, God wants you back. I've got one more scripture for you this morning. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9. It says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. With everything going on, I'm not sure what changes there are taking place in your personal life right here, right now. I don't know the ways that maybe you've been faithless or maybe you've drifted away, but I do know this, God is faithful and true. And the storms of life, if you press into Him, He will be that anchor for your soul. In the battles of life, if you'll turn to Him today, He will be the fortress that you can run into. And the shifting sands of our culture today, He, Jesus Christ, can be that solid rock on which you can stand firm. Why? Because our God is faithful. Remember this. He's an unchanging God in a changing world.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure.
Good morning, everyone. We hope you're enjoying our services together this morning on this Easter Sunday. Now, as we're going to prepare our minds to partake of the Lord's Supper together, let's focus our attention on one of the greatest blessings that we share as God's children, and that's the blessing of unity. We recognize that this unity is a deep spiritual one, not a physical one that the world loves. And as we share in partaking of the ceremony together, it unites us more than any other ceremony ever could. So it's ironic, really, when we consider that when Jesus instituted this feast of unity in the upper room so many years ago, he was actually surrounded by a great deal of disunity among his closest followers. Many of his apostles, in just a few minutes, are going to begin arguing with each other about who is going to be the greatest. And we know about Judas. Judas, who was already distrusted by many, or maybe even all of his fellow apostles, had already made his plans to betray his Savior and Lord. Well, in the middle of this very disappointing scene, Jesus calls his apostles' attention to two simple ingredients that had been included in the Passover supper that they had just celebrated together: unleavened bread and wine. He tells them at this point that the bread is no longer simply going to represent the Israelites' hasty retreat from Egyptian captivity, but from this moment on, it was going to represent his soon-to-be broken and dead fleshly body. And the wine had been a common and really inexpensive part of their common spiritual worship. But Jesus tells them now that this wine is going to represent the most costly sacrifice ever made, and that's going to be his own blood, soon to be shed on the cross. His blood that is going to be required for God to usher in his final and perfect covenant under his Son, Jesus Christ. Not many minutes after that, he's going to offer a beautiful prayer that many of us are very familiar with. It's found in the book of John in chapter 17. And in that prayer, he prays for several things, two of which are unity among his apostles, but he also prays for us. He prays for us today. And in John 17, verses 20 and 21, we read these words: "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me." Now, about 20 years later, the Apostle Paul is going to find himself writing a very painful letter to the church in Corinth. Now, the Corinthians church was not the unified body that Christ had prayed for in the upper room. Instead, they were really the model of infighting and self-centeredness and really disunity. But Paul sought to unify them further by reminding them of the common heritage that they had in the past and the common present that they have as a family together. In the 10th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians, we read these words: "I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud, and they all passed through the sea. They all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we, who are many, are one body, for we all share the one loaf." Two simple ingredients: unleavened bread and the fruit of the vine. Simple, but perfectly unifying. Let's bow as we offer thanks for the bread. Our Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful day that you have given us, the day that we celebrate the resurrection of your Son. But Father, now we are concentrating on his sacrifice. We thank you, Father, for his eagerness, for his willingness to serve as that perfect sacrifice for us. Thank you for giving so deeply of yourselves, and help us, Father, give of ourselves deeply to you in return. This we ask through the name of your Son and in accordance with your will. Amen. Let's now pray for the fruit of the vine. Our Father, again, we thank you so much for the things that you have provided for us, and especially the blood of your Son. Father, as we live our lives, we pray that you would help us understand that this blood is the greatest gift that we have ever received. And we pray, Father, that as we go forth from this place, that you would help us live our lives as sacrifices to you. Thank you again, Father, for your Son and for his blood shed for us. This we ask again through his name and all in accordance with your will. Amen. Thank you all for sharing this service with us. We pray that you enjoy the rest of this wonderful Easter Sunday. God bless.
For all of you who have joined us during our streaming services here at the Waters Road Church of Christ today, we want to thank you for spending your time here with us today. But before we go, I know we're not in our normal assembly, but if there's anyone out there today who needs to make their life right with Jesus Christ, if you're out there this morning after singing these songs of praise, after hearing the word of the Lord this morning, maybe something has touched your heart and you've realized your status with God is not where it needs to be. I want you to know that your church family here at Waters Road is still here for you. If you're not yet a Christian, yes, I know we're in the middle of a pandemic, but that will not stop us from honoring your request to be baptized into Jesus Christ. If there's anyone out there who needs to obey the gospel and be buried with Christ in baptism, please let myself know. Contact me. Contact one of our shepherds or one of your fellow members here at Waters Road. Let them know that you would like to be buried with Christ in baptism. Or maybe you're someone here this morning watching this stream who realizes you need the prayers of your brethren. And you may wonder, well, I'm not able to be around them this morning, but you can still ask for their prayers. Please simply reach out to me or one of our shepherds, or turn to a brother or sister in Christ that you know and love and share with them what's on your heart and what need you have in prayer. We're here for you as God's family. If you're not a member of the Waters Road Church of Christ, we'd love for you to let us know your intention of becoming part of our family. You can still do that as well. If there's any way that we can assist any of our church family or any of our guests, please contact us either using the comments section below or by going to our website or simply sending me an email. Thank you very, very much, and God bless you.